Good afternoon and welcome to Gardens of California. My name is Gerald Turney and I'm your host and instructor. And this is the show where we talk about everything about plants and gardens, from apples to zinnias and trees to turf. So we are live and on the air, and you can call in with any questions you have about your garden or plant materials. And I'll do my best to answer your questions or direct you where you can get those answers. Now, we always start our show off with upcoming garden events. You can put them on your calendar and get out and enjoy our wonderful fall weather and enjoy some of our local garden events. So let's take a look at some of our upcoming events and see what we can entice you to go out and do. So one of our first events is the 2010 Annual Winter Cactus and Succulent Show and Sale at the Los Angeles County Arboretum and Botanic Gardens in Arcadia. This is free with admissions. This will be November 6th and 7th from 9 to 4. And you can give them a call at 626-821-3222 for more information. This will be a great opportunity to see a whole bunch of different cactus and succulents and purchase some and talk to some of the experts. This is a big show. It's really quite spectacular. So try it out to that. Also at the Arboretum is the Turtle Expedition. That's Saturday, November 6th. You can take a quick look at that as well if you're at the Cactus and Succulent Show. That's 8 to 5 p.m. Again, free with admission. And give them a call if you have any questions at 626-821-3222. In addition to that, the Organic Fruit and Vegetable Gardening will be at the Arboretum of Los Angeles County on December 6th from 12 to 3 p.m. And this will give you an opportunity to learn more about growing organic fruits and vegetables in your own garden and talk to some of the experts in that area. We have any more? We have the Cactus and Succulent Sale at the Fullerton Arboretum. And this will be an opportunity for people who live farther south and maybe don't want to go all the way up to Arcadia. If you're down in Orange County, get on over to the Fullerton Arboretum. It's a wonderful arboretum. You can get a look at all the plant materials they grow. That's December 3rd through 5th from 10 to 4 p.m. And this, again, is an opportunity to maybe switch over some of your high water use plants in your garden to some of the cactus and succulents that will use significantly less water and probably require quite a bit less care. And let's see if we have anything else on our list today. No, that's all we have on our upcoming events. Now, today I'm going to be lecturing about camellias. But before I get into today's lecture, I want to talk about a couple little things that have come up in the past and remind you that we are live and on the air, and you can call 1-800-339-1193 if you have any questions about your garden or any problems you're having in your garden, or especially any camellia problems, because today we're going to talk about camellias. But I want to talk about fruit split briefly. We often get calls, and I often get calls in my regular day job. If you're not familiar with what I do during the day, I'm a senior biologist, plant pathologist for the Los Angeles County Agricultural Commissioner's Office, and I have a plant pest diagnostic lab, or I should say a plant pathology diagnostic lab, in Southgate. In fact, if you contact us at the lab, we answer your questions as well, and you can send us your samples, and we don't charge for our diagnostic services through the Agricultural Commissioner's Office. But anyway, I often get calls, especially about fruit split and citrus and oranges that split open. And this time of year is when you really see them a lot. And here it is. Here's a navel orange that is off my own tree in my own backyard. And you can see that this fruit has split and is ripped open. And it really ruined the fruit. So people call it in. And you're always going to get maybe a little bit of this, especially on the navels. But the reason you get this is because of inconsistent watering or excessive watering. Now, the rind matures through the summer months and into the fall. The rind actually becomes mature and is no longer soft and pliable. And it's really now a mature rind. And the tree will then, in the fall months, take up a whole lot of water. And when it takes up that water, it'll then split the fruit. So it's really important. If you're getting a lot of split on your citrus, you need to stop watering your citrus so much in the summer months. I mean, as we go into the fall months. Now, remember, you shouldn't be watering your citrus all that much anyway, in terms of frequency. In the spring and the fall, typically you'll water your citrus once a month with a good deep soak to a depth of 2 to 3 feet. That may take an hour or two of very slow application rate, just a hose dribbling on it or a sinker hose, something like that. And you can always take a rod and shove it into the ground, like a steel rod or something like that. And it'll go into the ground as deep as the water will. Once it hits the dry soil, it'll pretty much stop. It'll be very difficult to push any farther. And once you get the water down to about 2 feet, maybe even a little more, then that's as deep as you need to water the soil for citrus. And then, you know, in the spring and fall, you do that once a month. And if you're, especially if you're in a hot inland valley, you'd move that up to about twice a month every 2 weeks during July, August, September. But once you get into October, our days get shorter and we're getting cooler, then you can start watering once a month again. So here we are, end of October, and by the way, happy Halloween. Today is Halloween. And I thought about talking about pumpkins, but I wasn't prepared for pumpkins, so we'll have to use that on a different day to lecture. But so in October, you really should have only watered once, and now we're going in, tomorrow will be the beginning of November. So you only water once. In fact, we just had a good rainstorm over the weekend. We had about a half an inch of rain, at least in the San Gabriel Valley. And I have to check and see how much rain other parts of Southern California got. But a half an inch is a pretty significant rainfall. That'll give you a little bit of a soak. But you only want to water your citrus once during November, a good deep soak. And then once we get in December, again, you'd only water once a month, depending on rain. If you get a good rainstorm, if you get an inch of rain or so, then you won't need to water that in December, or, you know, of course, we'll probably get rain again in January and February. You don't need to water your citrus during the winter months. The rain will be more than sufficient. They're really going dormant in the winter. They aren't actively growing anymore. The fruit is maturing. Of course, we're talking mostly about navels, but that's how you would water up any citrus. So this is a fruit split, and we get a lot of calls on it. I have only a couple on my whole tree is split. And I don't have an automated watering system under that particular tree. I only hand water it, because I only need to water it once a month. So I don't need an automated system to water something that only needs water once a month. And in the summer, I step it up every 2 weeks because I live in the San Gabriel Valley, and it's pretty hot. And that soil that I have where that tree is actually well drained, and so it's not a heavy clay. If I were in heavy clay, I would only water every 3 weeks in the summer. But if that's really a loamy soil where that tree is growing, so I get pretty good drainage. If I was out on a sandy soil out in the desert, I would probably even move my watering up to once a week. If you're out in Coachella or Palm Springs and you're growing citrus out there, once you get really hot in the summer, you may need to move that up to once a week because that sandy soils, they won't retain any water. It drains so rapidly. Another thing I want to point out real quick before we move on, and I just want to remind the control room to try and get me back my photos before we move on to talk about camellias, because I don't have my set of pictures, but this is coleus, and we talked about coleus a little while ago, and these are cuttings from a bowl of coleus I grew at home. I grew it from seed, and these are only about 3 weeks that I made the cuttings, and I actually brought them in and showed them on the program. And you can see this is how much root, this is just in water. I didn't even put it in the soil. So you can see that in 3 weeks, it's grown quite a bit of root. Coleus is one of the easiest plants to root. And you can see, you know, of course, these are big cuttings. You don't have to take such large cuttings. I just happened to break these off to show you the different varieties. And since I broke them off, I thought, well, why don't I root them? And then I'll have some more plants to, you know, I can use these as landscape materials. It's really kind of fun to grow color in your garden from foliage plants rather than just from flowers. And coleus is one of the great plants for doing that because you can get such, you know, vivid color. You can see here, you got really quite different color and leaf forms. And then here's a couple more. Let's just take a look at these real quick and knock that on the ground. I'm going to get everything wet here in a second. But here's another variety, a different pattern in the leaf. And you can see it's rooted quite nicely in just 3 weeks. These are ready to go into a pot. You can grow them on a windowsill, especially at south or west facing. They like a little bit of light in order to get the good color in their leaves. If you grow them in too deep a shade, then they tend to be a little greener and have less color in them, and that's a real pretty red. And then here's one that's nearly all green, but it's still enough material and in a light lime green. So you can see that it only took about 3 weeks to get roots, and now they're ready to go into some pots. And I'll plot those up later this evening at my home, and I'll have some new plants. And I managed to get my table all wet. But that's okay. We're talking about plants, and if you don't like getting wet, then you shouldn't be working with plants. Or dirty, for that matter. Now let's talk about camellias. Now, camellias are really it's a genus. There are about 200 species of camellia. And they have a really fascinating history. They're very popular ornamental in Southern California, but they have a very important role to play, or they had an important role to play in the exploration of the New World. And you might say, well, how is that? They're just a plant. Well, the early explorers that were traveling around the world were looking for spices and silk and things like that to bring back to Europe. In fact, the captain of a boat that made it all the way to the Orient, to Japan, and was able to bring back tea or other spices or silks could literally make himself a very, very wealthy man with just one voyage. Of course, it would take nearly a year or more to make that voyage. So, camellias are native to Southeast Asia, mostly China and Japan, but also Korea and Vietnam and some of the other Southeast Asian countries. Camellias were named in honor of George Campbell by Linnaeus, who, of course, is the father of plant taxonomy, of naming plants. And the Camellia sinensis, one of the 200 or so species, is the tea plant that is used to make tea, to make both green and black tea. And tea use is recorded as far back as 500 BC. In fact, in China, the tea plant was pressed into blocks, and that was used as a currency. And the farther you traveled with that block of tea, the more valuable it became. When tea was finally discovered by the Europeans and brought back to Europe, it was extremely expensive. It was about 50 pounds, English pounds, for an ounce. Now, you can imagine that's phenomenally expensive. We think of tea today as being quite cheap. Adjust my chair here if I can. Whoop, there we go. That's a little more comfortable. And tea was kept in silver tea boxes. Only by the wealthiest families in Europe and in England. And let's take a quick look here. So the first drawing of a camellia that was made by a European was in 1702 by James Petitverre. And then in 1745, there was a Natural History of Birds published by George Edwards in England, contained curved plants of camellia. And at that time, they called the camellia the Chinese rose. And of course, when the explorers made it to Japan and discovered tea, found tea being drank in Japan, and of course, it had been drank in China long before it was actually used in Japan. It was really a Chinese development. They wanted the tea plant. And so, the Japanese and the Chinese, they didn't want to give them the tea plant because they wanted to control the trade of the actual end product tea. And so they gave them other camellias. They gave them Camellia japonica. And those were brought back to Europe, and they were a sensation because they bloomed in the winter. And they didn't have a lot of winter blooming materials in Europe. And they're actually quite striking, beautiful flowers. And so they were referred to as the Chinese rose, the China rose, the first Camellia reticulata. Now, I should point out that there are, of the 200 or so species of camellia that exist in the wild, there are really maybe a half a dozen or so, maybe a dozen, that are available to be grown in your garden. The most commonly grown camellia is Camellia japonica, and then the second one that's very popular is Camellia sasanqua, And then another one is fairly popular, Camellia reticulata. And the first Camellia reticulata was brought to England in 1820 from Canton by Richard Ross. And in fact, there is a Camellia reticulata named after Captain Ross, and it's a beautiful flower. And I'll get into more about the differences between the species in a moment. Tea growing was actually attempted in the United States in both Savannah and Charleston, but it failed. It didn't work very well. The first import from England to the United States of Camellia japonica was in 1797 and 1798. What you see here is Camellia japonica, the wild form of Camellia japonica, with just a single, what we call single, the flower is a single, rather than being doubled or one of the other forms. Now, the history in California is quite interesting. The Camellia pioneer of the West was James Warren of Sacramento. Sacramento has a very large collection of camellias around the capital, and they have it's a very popular place to grow camellias. Warren received his first plants in Sacramento in 1852. So, now, camellias gained a lot of popularity, and by 1920, Sacramento was named a camellia city. So, an interesting note about California history of camellias. And in 1945, the American Camellia Society was formed. There are six flower forms in camellias, and if we want to bring this picture up real quick, we had it full screen just a moment ago, but we can bring it up full screen again. And we'll take a look here. You can see the flower here only has one, two, three, maybe five petals or so. And that's a single. A single flower will only have about five petals. And we can look at photo number four as well. And this is this photograph number four is of Crimson King. Let's bring that up full screen. And you can see that this is a rather simple bloom compared to what we'll see in a moment. This is Crimson King, and this is a single flower, and this is Camellia japonica. And let's see, there's one, two, three, four, five. Maybe there's five or six petals. It can vary, but those are singles. And singles can be quite nice and make very lovely ornamentals. Now, if we take a look at number six, we'll see Camellia japonica and bring this up. And you can see it's got quite a few more petals, and this is referred to as a semi-double. And there's also a semi-double rose form. We'll show you that in a moment. So this is a semi-double. This particular one is April Snow, and it is a Camellia japonica. And let's move on to photo number seven to see another semi-double. This again is another semi-double. And then we'll take a look at number eight, which is Camellia japonica pine cone, which is, this is a semi-double rose form. So, in fact, there are a number of camellias, when you look at the flower, they're very, very similar to a rose. But this is referred to as a semi-double. It's got quite a few more petals than the single form. And the single form is really the wild form. But of course, the Chinese and the Japanese, and probably throughout Asia for that matter, hybridized and bred these camellias and developed all these flower forms over the years, over many, many years. Obviously, they've been growing camellias in Japan for several thousand years, and probably all this Camellia japonica is native to Japan. And many of the other camellias are native to China. They've been used in their gardens for thousands of years. Now, one of my favorite varieties, or flower forms, I should say, is the peony form. This is called the anemone form. I misspoke. This is, let's take a look at number nine and bring that up full screen. And this is the Camellia japonica, and it's called Elegant Supreme. And this is the anemone form. And the anemone form has a row of petals around the outside like this that lay flat, and then all the stamens in the middle have become petaloid. And so you've got this this clump in here that looks like an anemone flower. And now, the interesting thing about this particular variety, Elegance Supreme, is that it has many, many what we call spores. That's when a branch on a plant will develop a new form or a new color flower. They call them chimeras or spores. So you have a big bush, and on one branch you have different flowers or different leaves, and those are called spores. And so this particular variety of Camellia japonica, Elegance Supreme, has many spores, and some of them are pure white and with slightly different forms of the flower. And it's one of my favorites. In fact, and I don't know if I've got maybe I should have a picture of it, and we'll see. I do. It's coming up. But let's take a look at another anemone form, which would be number 11, and we'll take a look at a few of these anemone forms, bring this up. So you see again, it's got the, you don't see any stamens on these. You see here the petals on the outside that lay basically flat, and then all the stamens have become petaloid in the middle. So that's the anemone form. And I'll show you another one. This is actually one of my, the next one here is number 12, and this is Elegant Champagne. This is by far one of the most striking and beautiful camellias you can grow. Very large bloom, 5 to 6 inches across, and again, you can see the anemone form there, where the stamens in here have all become petaloid, and the petals on the outside lay flat. These are so big and large that often they hang upside down on the plant and face down. That's the only kind of drawback to some of the larger bloom types of camellias, or for that matter, many different plant materials. The flowers, if they're really big flowers, they tend to hang down. In some plant materials, that actually is nice because then you can put them in a hanging basket and the flowers will hang down and look at you. Like fuchsias, a lot of the fuchsias that cascade, you can put them in a basket and the flowers hang down. When you have shrubs in the garden, that's not the best thing to have your flowers all pointing down, but it's just spectacular. And I just, I love Elegant Champagne. It's one of my absolute favorites. And then we can take a double quick look at 13. That's another anemone form. This one is referred to, this is a Ballet Queen, you know, pink anemone form, really, really pretty. There are literally thousands of named cultivars, cultivated varieties of camellias. And now, this next one I want to show you is a semi-double. And it's Camellia, it's a hybrid, it's number 14, and it's softly pink is the name of this particular Camellia, and it's a semi-double, and really pretty flower, really, really nice. Now, by far the most popular of the various varieties, flower forms, is this one right behind me. This is a formal double, and this should be, I'm not sure, this looks like Jonuzu, but it may be Sweet Olive. No, I'm not sure. I don't know if that's number 15 or not. But I have one here in my hand, actually, that I picked this morning off a plant in my own garden. I had an early bloom. Now, I haven't talked about the difference in the species yet. I'll get to that in a minute, but I'm kind of lucky. I have this is a formal double, and you can see that in the formal double, the center never really opens up all the way, and all of them, you know, are very, it's a very tight array of petals that lay back and flat, and you don't see any stamens. You're not going to get any stamens, and you're definitely not going to get seed off of a formal double. You never really get seed from formal doubles because there's no stamens. But this is one in my garden, and it was blooming. And I'll bring this back up in a second to talk about the differences in the species. And then here's a rose formal double, which is called Nuzio's Bella, where I say this is Camellia japonica. This is another formal double. And this may be one of the best of all the formal doubles is Bonin's Supreme, and that's a really, really nice one. So the formal doubles are some of the, this is one behind me, it's one of the new introductions from Nuzio's nursery. It's called Nuzio's Bella Rosa. This is a very large formal double, bright red, about 5 to 6 inches across. They can even be bigger than that. really quite striking. And then here's another one, Sweet Olive, is number 18. And bring that up full screen, and you can see that, you know, formal doubles are really, really spectacular blooms. They're really, really fun. And that's one of my favorites. That in the anemone forms, especially the Elegance Champagne and Elegance Supreme and the Elegance Variegated. There's a whole line of Elegance that are just really fun to grow and really fun to have. Now, the sixth flower form is the peony form, and of course, they look like a peony flower. So let's take a look at number 20, and let's see if we can bring number 20 up full screen, or bring it up and take a look at number 20. Here it is. This is a peony form, and it looks very much like a peony. Many of the reticulatas, this is familiar reticulata, and it's Anne's Delight. But there are a number of reticulata varieties, so that's the peony form, and they have stamens, and you will get seed from that. And all you can also have a full peony and a semi peony, but now you're splitting hairs. The peony form, all the petals are quite ruffled, and they fluff up very much like a peony bloom. That's why where they get their name, the peony. I remind our viewers that we're live and on the air, and our phone number is 1-800-339-1193. So give us a call. Maybe you've got some camellias in your yard and you'd like to ask them about them. Now, camellia flowers will come in anything from white to pink to red, and they can be variegated. They can have a pink edge and a white throat. They can be striped, candy striped, you know, just a whole multitude. There are some yellow blooming camellia species, but they're not quite as spectacular as the flowers you get in Japonica, Camellia reticulata, and Camellia sesangua. They tend to be smaller blooms and not so showy, but they're a great source of breeding for flower color. And so let's take a look at one of the yellow ones. This is photograph number 21. This is the yellow camellia. This is a Camellia chrysantha. And chrysantha is a yellow blooming camellia. It's being used to hybridize. Now, just because they're on the genus camellia doesn't mean you can actually cross them all. You know, it's very easy to cross some of the species, but some of the other species are hard to cross. You won't get good seed, or the seeds, you just won't get seed. But so there are now some nice yellow camellias that you can get. And the other thing they're breeding for is scent, scented camellias, because for the most part, camellias are not scented. They can be beautiful and spectacular, but there's no scent. And then there is another yellow, which is buttermint. Let's take a look at number 22, and bring that up. Let's see if that shows that yellow color. These look a little white, but actually a faint yellow. And it's a nice hybrid if you're looking for a yellow camellia. Now, let's talk a little bit about the differences between the three major species. And then we'll talk about the conditions and how to grow your camellias. But by far the most popular, the most widespread camellia grown is Camellia japonica. Japonicas tend to be upright and thick shrubs. And if we look here on this, you can see they got fairly good sized leaves that are dark green and very shiny. Their peak of the bloom is in January. They'll start blooming. There are some early japonicas that will start blooming right now in October, but they really start to bloom in mid-December, late December, and they reach their peak in January and February, and then by March they'll be done blooming. So that's Camellia japonica, and they tend to be, you know, they make a good hedge. They get real thick. There are cascading varieties, but most of them grow upright, and so that's Camellia japonica. Now, I don't have a sample of Camellia sesangua. Sesangua have a smaller leaf. It's dark green and shiny, but it's a much smaller leaf. They tend to have blooms that are singles, but you can get, in sesangua, you can also get the other types of camellia blooms, anemone, and I don't know if I've seen formal doubles in sesangua, but you can get most of the color forms. One of the most popular of all the camellias is Yuletide, which is a Camellia sesangua. Sesangua are blooming right now. They start blooming in October, and by December they'll be done blooming. And one of the big differences is that the flower on Jutalaca, all the petals are fused to the base. So when this flower falls off as one unit. It falls on the ground. But the cycles, they're not united at the base, and the petals fall apart, and they come down. And underneath your cycle bush, you'll have a bunch of petals and not solid flowers. And that looks really quite nice in the fall, to have this carpet of petals underneath your bush, rather than just solid blooms, which aren't so nice. And actually, so the cycles tend to not be as big as japonicas. They don't make as good of a hedge material. And they tend to cascade. There are upright varieties. In fact, Yuletide, which I just mentioned, is an upright variety. Whereas many of the other Camellia sesequa varieties are pendulous, or they cascade. They come up and arc over like this. And they do bloom early. They bloom now. Now, reticulatas is the other fairly, well, I wouldn't say common, you know, the product is by far the most common, and then you see quite a few sesequas out there in people's gardens. But you don't see a whole lot of reticulatas. They tend to be small trees. They don't get real thick. They're kind of more of a small tree than a thick hedge. They have a large leaf, but it's a dull green. It's not shiny green. And they tend to have very large, very showy flowers. So the reticulatas are really fun if you like big, showy flowers. And there's a lot of peony forms in the reticulatas. And there are formal doubles. You can get all the flower forms in reticulata. And now, of course, there are many hybrids with the other species, like Camellia sinensis, Camellia oleifera. There are many other species of Camellia. And a very interesting growing species. There is a nursery, New Source Nursery, up in Altadena, that specializes in Camellias and azaleas. They probably have about 400 different types of Camellias. 200 or 300 different types of azaleas. And so if you're into camellias and azaleas, this is the nursery to visit, and especially coming up through the winter months, you can go up and see all the different types of camellias that are on bloom. They always put them out on display. Now, the growing conditions for your camellias are not that different from a lot of other shrubbery. They like high organic matter in the soil. What doesn't? They like a well-drained soil. What doesn't? And they tend to need bright light, but if you're in the hot inland valleys, you need to protect them from the hot afternoon sun. So they do best on eastern exposure or northern exposure. And if you put them on the south or west side of your home, they need to be under the shade of a large tree or some type of canopy, shade cloth. If they get full sun in the afternoon, especially in the hot inland valleys, that will burn them. They cannot really take that. And it's really hard on them. So they just fry the foliage, especially in August, September, when we get up in 100 degrees. That big blast of heat we had, we were 110. So that was really hot for camellias, and they needed to be in the shade. So again, they do best on an eastern exposure, where they get the morning sun and they're protected from the afternoon sun, or under the canopy of a large tree. And again, on the east side of the tree is best, rather than the south or west side of a large tree. Now, I know after the war, after World War II, and there was a big boom of housing in California, a lot of people were planting their camellias under native oaks. And, you know, as far as the community is concerned, that was fine. But our native oaks don't like that much water. The camellias, when they're young, you're going to have to water them fairly frequently when you first plant them. But then, as soon as you get established, you don't need to water them all that much. And if you've got them under oaks, you can spot water them. Instead of using a sprinkler that waters the entire area under the oak, just water the camellia itself right around the base of the camellia so you're not soaking the whole soil under the oak. Now, the Huntington Botanical Gardens and Descanso Gardens, they've planted all the camellias under the oaks. And then a lot of these oaks have oak root rot fungus, which is Armillaria malia. And when you water under oaks during the summer, Armillaria grows much faster. It makes a really excellent, you know, growing conditions for the fungus. Not so good for the oak, and then you'll lose your oaks. They'll thin out, they'll either fall over, or they'll just go into decline. And after about 5 years of watering under an established oak that didn't get summer irrigation, you can see severe decline in a lot of oaks. So I wouldn't plant them under our native oaks. They're not a real compatible plant for native oaks, although historically in Southern California, a lot of people have grown them that way. So if you're growing camellias at home and you have any questions about your camellias, why don't you give us a call? Our number is 1-800-339-1193. And I have a video clip about breeding camellias, so I'd like to go to that clip now and show you how various camellia enthusiasts can hybridize their own camellias, come up with your own seed and your own crosses. Let's take a look at this video clip from YouTube, actually. Let's take a look.
We have two individual girls who are going to be very, very, very famous. The artist is one of the things. The second is the Zero Breeding Program. Every month of the year, this plant is flowers. So it's very unique in Canary Deep. So we use this as an air can to attempt to create more hyperborean plants. The Canary Breeding Program at Walnut Gardens has three main stages. First, we identify the parents. Then, we make the cross. Finally, we collect and grow out the hybrid seed and evaluate them to see what traits were inherited from each parent. After collecting pollen from our paternal parent, we select a flower that is shown in color but has yet to open. Flowers at this stage are ready for maceration.
What you want to do is pull the seed off using the leaves and work your way around the flower, trying not to cut into the center. Now you can peel this off. Then you want to make sure that none of these anthers are shedding pollen, because you don't want this pollen to get on the end of this ear and then you have a flower that is pollinated and you want to bring in the genes from a different commander. So you need to cut all these stamens off. And there we go. There's a flower that I inoculated 2 days ago and bagged. So it wouldn't be contaminated with pollen from this one. I'm talking with pollen from our male parents. And then just tap it right on the end. So that's what you want to do for her. Don't get covered with pollen bags. All the flowers from falling onto this flower will also prevent pollinators, bees, bugs, flies from being around our non-party species. This is a good example of how you can tell if the stigma is receptive. Because when I touch the pollen, it's clear that the yellow pollen is sticking to the end. So if you go to pollinate a flower, and you cannot easily see that pollen sticking to the end, you need to wait another day or so to make sure that the stigma is
receptive. Well, that's exactly how you hybridize. So you can use that technique actually for many different plant materials. What you do is you go in and you cut off all the petals and you cut off all the anthers or the stamens, that's the male part of the flower, and you save the pistil, and then you cover it up to protect it from any pollen coming from another plant or flowers on the same bush, and then you go get your pollen from the male parent that you want to use, and you make your cross. Then you cover it up again, and then, of course, that'll develop into a seed pod, and you collect the seeds and grow them out. And now, it can take quite a few years. You collect that seed and plant it, and it's not going to grow like lightning. And in a year, you might get a plant about this big, in 2 years, in 3 years. But it may take 5 or 6 or even 7 years before you get a bloom. And that's a long time to wait. So typically what you do is, once you get your plant up and it's about a year old, you can take a cutting off of that and graft it onto a big rootstock, bigger rootstock, and then you'll get a flower within about 2 years. And you can see the results of your crosses rather quickly by grafting them on to larger rootstocks rather than waiting for the original plant to bloom on its own. And that's another technique that's used in many different plant materials, not just camellias. So, we've talked about the three most common species, Camellia sessenica, and Camellia japonica, Camellia reticulata, and when they bloom and the different flower forms. We talked a little bit about their growing conditions. They need bright light in order to bloom well. If they're in really dark shade, they're not going to do all that well. So you can't grow them under an avocado tree. Avocado trees are extremely dense and thick, and there's not enough light penetrating. They'll do better under a tree like a mimosa, a very thin tree that lets a little light through, or on the eastern exposure where you get the morning sun and afternoon shade. And watering, that first year when you plant a new plant, you do need to water them about once a week. Don't let them go dry. But once they're established, after 2 or 3 years, you can start watering camellias really in spring only about once a month, spring and the fall about once a month, and when you get into the summer about every 2 weeks. If you're on a sandier soil, you might have to go once a week, or if we get really hot, then maybe once a week. Good deep soak. Now, fertilizing camellias. Camellias are very sensitive to salts, just like an avocado is very sensitive to salts. So never use manure. There's two manures. Cow manure is very salty, and in fact, I wouldn't use it on any plant material for that matter. But it's really detrimental to fruit trees, and it's not good for camellias at all. You fertilize camellias 3 times a year, spring, summer, and fall, and you can use a low nitrogen material. You don't want to use a real high nitrogen, strong fertilizer. Most of the camellia enthusiasts use cottonseed meal, which is about 7% nitrogen. Cottonseed meal is non-soluble, means that's a breakdown over about 8 weeks for the nitrogen and the other nutrients, the potassium and the phosphorus. Iron, everything that's in there, for that to break down and be released into the soil by bacteria and fungi. They break it down, and the plant can absorb the nitrogen. So you get a slow, continuous feed with cottonseed meal. Some of the camellia enthusiasts, people in the camellia societies, like to use 4 parts cottonseed meal and 1 part blood meal. And the blood meal is about 15% nitrogen, so that just kicks it up a little bit, makes it a little hotter. A lot of the enthusiasts also like to use the first fertilization in early spring, in about February. They'll use fish emulsion, which is very, very weak. It's only about 1 or 2% nitrogen. And I see we have a question, what is blood meal? Blood meal is a fertilizer made from blood, and it also has to be broken down. It's non-soluble. There are a lot of what we call meals. There's cottonseed meal, blood meal, bone meal. They make a kelp fertilizer product, basically the same thing. These are natural products that have a fairly high nitrogen content compared to maybe some other things, but they can be used as fertilizers, but they have to decompose after you apply them. They're not soluble, as opposed to things like ammonium sulfate or calcium nitrate. Of course, you can't get ammonium nitrate. That's what farmers use, and it's explosive, so that's not sold to homeowners for good reason. But these are nitrogen salts, nitrogenous salts, that are water-soluble, and when you mix them, with water or put them on the soil and water them in, all that nitrogen is available all at once. And those type of products are very easy to burn a plant with. So you have to be very careful about when you're using them, and you should be careful when you fertilize any plant for that matter. But it's much more difficult to burn a plant with something like cottonseed meal or blood meal, although I guess I should digress momentarily and tell you about when I was working at the Arboretum. I worked there for a couple of years as a biologist and research horticulturalist, and a homeowner came in with her oleanders. This is before oleanders were dying from scorch disease, and they were all burnt and brown, and she was asking us what was wrong with them, and I asked her if she'd fertilized them, and she said, yeah, she put a cup of blood meal on each plant. That was a 5-gallon oleander, and she put a cup of blood meal on each plant at planting, and that was way too much, and the blood meal just fried them, burned them real hard. If you soak them real good, maybe they would come back, but you can still use too much of any fertilizer, so read the labels and be very careful. Camellias are low-feeding plants. They are not like orchids or roses where people push them with nitrogen once a month or twice a month and push a lot of growth and push a lot of flowers. They are low feeders. You feed them three times a year with a low nitrogen fertilizer. So I see we have a phone call. Let's go to our first caller. Carrie, calling from South Pasadena. You're on the air.
Okay. I had a question about my camellias. I have the flowers just start to open. You know, they don't quite open, and they stop opening, and then they fall off the bush. And then I have a whole bunch of these partially open buds on the bottom of my tree. This happened last year. Not this year, but it was happening last year.
Okay, that actually is a fairly common problem on camellias. We call it bulldozing, where the flower starts to open, and then it stops, and then it just falls off the bush. This generally shows that there's an overall problem with the plant. Some varieties are prone to this more than others. You see it more often on the formal doubles than you see it on the other flower forms. But it may go to how often you're watering and whether you're fertilizing. And I think it also is tied into some root rot problems. The biggest problem in terms of the overall health of a camellia is controlling Phytophthora root rot. Phytophthora root rot is a very common root rot that we see on many, many plant materials. So what you need to do is not water too often. Once a month, spring and the fall. Twice a month, summer. Put gypsum underneath the canopy of the tree in the spring and the fall, about a quarter inch. Put a thick layer of mulch underneath the canopy of the tree in the spring and the fall, and then fertilize three times a year with a low nitrogen fertilizer. It may take a year or two for it to stop doing that.
Okay.
But I think it's an overall problem with the entire health of the plant. It starts to open the flowers, and then they fall off. There are varieties that tend to be prone to this. And if you can't get it to stop, you know, one of the things that a lot of people like to do is cut it down to about maybe 2 feet above the ground and graft it to a different variety. That's kind of a drastic solution, but a lot of the enthusiasts do that to grow newer varieties, and they actually take off and grow very, very fast because you've got a big rootstock.
Oh, okay.
Okay.
I'll try some of those things. Well, thank you so much. I enjoy your show.
Okay. Well, thank you for calling. Okay. Now, the other thing, you know, we've been talking mostly about the ornamental camellias, but there's also really the big heavyweight in the genus is Camellia sinensis. Now, sinensis is the tea plant. That's the plant that's used to make green and black tea. And, of course, when tea was found by the Europeans and they brought it back to Europe, it was a great sensation. We all think of it today as being fairly inexpensive and cheap. But back then, it was very expensive. As I mentioned before, it was kept in silver boxes in only the finest homes in England. But I think we have a video talking about tea. Let's go to that video.
Garden Time has been in the Chinese garden many times, but we've never been in the tea houses, the Tao of Tea, and I'm with Rodner. They're going to tell us more about where tea comes from, what kind of plants, and how we can actually grow those plants here in the Portland area.
Well, the birthplace of tea is the area of southern Yunnan in China, bordering with Burma, Laos, and Upper Assam, India. That's the genesis of tea. That's where it originated, and that's where you hear about the caravans that carry tea from southern China all the way through to the Middle East. That's the heart of where tea originated. You can grow tea here in Portland. In fact, I have several plants in my backyard here in Portland. One of them has been growing for the last 12, 13 years. And there's a few plants here in the Portland Chinese garden that are really very healthy and growing well.
And they're a camellia. And we usually see the big flowered ones, but these are different species.
Well, it's a family of camellia. But within camellia, the Camellia sinensis and the Camellia assamica are the two branches. The assamica is known as the big leaf varietal, which grows primarily in the subcontinent, the African tea growing countries, parts of southern China, and the sinensis, which is a small leaf, grows in more inland Chinese gardens and some gardens in India.
It So if we have it in our garden and William has one, if he went out now, he could pick those leaves to make tea, or is there a different time of year?
Well, first of all, the plants need to be about 4 to 5 years old before they will have the capacity to do anything. And you want to pick them only in the new growth seasons, primarily in spring, late summer, and sometimes early fall or winter, depending on the region. Here in the northwest, we get a really good spring crop. Once you pluck the leaves, you get a second summer crop, and you want to pluck only the new growth that comes out.
And so the different type of tea, and you sell many different teas, it depends on the processing. It's almost close to plants making tea. So the way that the different flavors come is when you come into the processing, and different kind of processing, you're telling us that they're sometimes very intricate and sometimes very easy.
Yes, and I'll speak more on a generalized basis. You can make all different categories of tea from your tea plant. For example, if you pluck just the new growth tips and the buds, and you dry them in a warm room, once it dries, that's more your white tea. If you were to pluck the leaves and immediately steam them, or if you were to take the leaves and roast them in a little wok, that's more the generalized style of making green tea. Long kinds of tea, if you let the leaves sit for a while, they lose a little moisture, and you bruise them, they start to begin a process called oxidation, which is where the oxygen enters and it starts a chemical reaction, and the leaves develop a flavor and a aroma. And then you do iterations of drying and cooling the leaf, that's what oolong style. For black tea, if you were to let them oxidize for a longer period of time, 3, 4, 5 hours, the leaves will turn from green to really dark, and that's more the style of making black tea. Now, this is again a very generalized way of talking about it. Each step has more intricate details, and people will think to make tea.
So, the best part of all of this is coming into the cup of tea and enjoying a cup of tea and seeing all the different teas they have to offer and learning so much and seeing all the processes. Thank you so much. It's been so informative. Appreciate it.
So there you go. That's a little insight into how the various types of tea are made. They're all really from the same plant, and it's just how you process the leaves that produces either white tea or green tea or black tea. But there are different varieties of the tea plant. There's the Assamica variety, and there's the Sinensis variety. And so then you get all these different types of tea. Now, India is one of the largest producers of tea in the world, and there are three main tea-producing areas in India: Darjeeling, Assam, and Nilgiri. Darjeeling is considered to be the best tea in India. This is due to their excellent growing conditions. They use the Chinese variety Sinensis, it's Camellia sinensis. This Assam is the largest producing area in India, and they produce 473,000 metric tons annually. Now, I see we have a question as to, can we grow tea in L.A.? Yes, you can. I don't know that you're going to be as successful growing that particular plant as it likes a cool, moist environment. So it would do better up on the Central Coast or up in Northern California, or we saw that there in Oregon, places like that. You're going to be able to grow Camellia sinensis a lot easier. They tend to have a hard time in hot inland valleys, and they don't like hard water. So we have hard water, and we have hot valleys in Southern California, and they suffer a little here in Southern California. You can still, people do grow them. You can buy them from New Sales Nursery up in Altadena. I know they carry them, and they have a couple different varieties. They tend to get a little browning on the edges of the leaves. And when I was curating the Camellia collection at the Huntington, we had quite a few plants of them we tried to grow in the garden, and they really struggled. It was a difficult plant for us to grow. I think it's the hot summers. They don't really like those hot, dry summers, and they don't like hard water. And we've got both, so that's hard. So if you're along the coast and you want to leash them with a distilled water or ionized water, deionized water, then you can probably be a little more successful. We didn't really go completely out of our way to try and get them to survive. We were just using our irrigation water. The large-leaved Assamese plant is used mainly for black tea. And you can also make oil from tea. You can press the seeds of Camellia sinensis or Camellia oleifera, and then you get Camellia oil or tea oil. And it is used in Japan and China for cooking, and it is also used for oiling wood as a wood preservative. And the wood of the Camellia plant is extremely hard and was used, it can be used here, obviously. It was used in China and Japan and Southeast Asia to make weapons and to make furniture. It's extremely hard, and it's beautiful wood. Some of the enthusiasts that were in the Camellia societies would take big, large trunks from trees that had been removed or had died, and they would make, lamp bases or gavels or rolling pins, and they're actually quite lovely. Now, there is a legend as to where tea actually originated, and one of the popular legends is that there was an emperor in China who was the inventor of agriculture and Chinese medicine. I'm going to mispronounce his name. Xin Yong, I believe, is his name. And he was drinking a bowl of boiling water sometime around the year 2737 BC. I don't know how they got it down to that exact year. When a few leaves were blown from a nearby tree into his water, changing the color of his water. The emperor took a sip of the brew and was pleasantly surprised in its flavor and restorative properties. And, of course, there is caffeine in tea, and that, as you well know, caffeine is a stimulant that wakes you up. There's also an alternative legend that dates back to the Tang Dynasty. And in this legend, the founder of Chang Buddhism accidentally fell asleep after meditating in front of a wall for 9 years. He woke up in such disgust at his weakness that he cut off his own eyelids. They fell to the ground and took root, growing into tea bushes. And that's a fun legend, although one that we can discount as to its accuracy. The Yunnan province has also been identified as the birthplace of tea, the Yunnan province of China, and the first area where humans figured out that eating tea leaves or brewing a cup of tea could be pleasant. And the world's oldest cultivated tea trees are believed to be upwards of 3,200 years old in Yunnan province. Now, tea wasn't drank in Japan until much later. You can find different introduction dates, but it's believed that in the year 1191, a Zen priest brought back tea seeds to Kyoto. Some of the tea seeds were given to the priest, and this became the basis for Yuji tea. The oldest tea specialty book in Japan, How to Stay Healthy by Drinking Tea, was written by Isai. The two-volume book was written in 1211, after his second and last visit to China. The first sentence states that tea is the ultimate mental and medical remedy and has the ability to make one's life more full and complete. And I agree wholeheartedly. I do enjoy tea. Teas spread to Japan, or actually it probably spread to Japan around the 6th century, not in 1191. And tea became a drink of the religious classes in Japan when Japanese priests and envoys sent to China to learn about its culture brought tea back to Japan. So even though they have Camellia japonica as a native Camellia to Japan, it's not, the tea plant itself was not native to Japan, and they didn't drink tea in Japan until much later. They'd been drinking it in China for hundreds of years. And it really became a drink of the royal classes. And the Emperor Saga of Japan encouraged the growth of tea plants. Now, there's another tea called lotus tea, which is a specialty product of the Vietnamese tea industry. And generally, this is a high-quality green tea and they are placed with lotus flowers for a day to acquire the scent of the lotus flower. Taiwan is famous for making of oolong tea and green tea, as well as many Western-styled teas. Now, in England, of course, England now today considers tea to be their national drink. The importing of tea into Britain began in the 1660s with the marriage of King Charles II and the Portuguese Princess Catherine, where she brought to the court the habit of drinking tea. The importing of tea into Britain began, Now, by the end of the 17th century, tea was taken as a drink, but mainly by the wealthy. By 1750, tea would be the national drink of England. Merchantmen ships delivered fabrics manufactured in Britain to India and China, but would return empty or partially full. To solve this problem, the East India Company began a vigorous public relations campaign to popularize tea among the common people in Britain and develop it as a viable return cargo. Britain had to pay for the tea, of course, but China had little need for British goods, so much of it was paid for with silver. As an alternative, Britain began producing opium in India and forced China to trade tea for opium as part of several treaties after the Opium Wars. So, here again, you can see how the tea plant played a critical role in a lot of historical events in world history. Now, to this day, tea is seen as a symbol of being British, but also to some as a symbol of British colonialism. American specialty tea market has quadrupled in the years from 1993 to 2008, now being worth close to $6.8 billion a year. So, tea is a big business. Now, I often think of tea as being very inexpensive, but since so many people drink it. And of course, we really can't ignore the Boston Tea Party. This, of course, was an act of a protest by American colonists against the British government, in which they destroyed crates of tea belonging to the British East India Company in Boston Harbor. It took place on December 16, 1773, and has been helping to spark the American Revolution. It's been seen as helping to spark the American Revolution, and remains to this day one of the most iconic events in American history. We've all heard of the Boston Tea Party. Tea is easily the most popular drink in the world in terms of consumption. It easily equals all other manufactured drinks in the world, including coffee, chocolate, soft drinks, and alcohol put together. So, more tea is drank around the world than all the other drinks we drink all together, comparatively. Most tea is consumed outside East Asia. Most of the tea that is consumed is produced on large plantations in India or Sri Lanka, and is destined to be sold to large businesses. Now, if you do want to grow tea, you want to plant it in a hole no deeper than the root ball. So any camellia, if you buy a camellia and you want to grow it, and I've mentioned this before, when you plant plants, and you're saved the most standard size is a 5 gallon pot or a 1 gallon pot, that's also very common. You don't dig the hole any deeper than the root ball. You dig just as deep as the root ball, and you want that top inch or so of the root ball to be above grade. You want to mix your backfill with the soil and peat moss. Now, peat moss is really excellent organic material to add to the soil, especially for camellias and azaleas. In fact, you can grow your azaleas in 100% peat, and they'll do much better. You want it once a week for the first year, and then once established, generally I would water once a month in the spring and the fall, and about twice a month in the summer. You can move that up, and as you're getting into late spring, you could be doing once every 2 weeks, and then in the hottest part of the summer, once a week. But it really depends exactly where you live. If you're along the coast and you're growing camellias, you should be able to get away with watering them twice a month in the summer months. In the San Gabriel Valley or in the San Fernando Valley or where you're really hot, you may have to go to once a week in August and September. And fertilize with a low nitrogen fertilizer 3 times a year. Now, We are live and on the air. You can give us a call at 1-800-339-1193. If you're growing tea in your garden, let us know how you're doing, because personally, I wasn't too successful growing my own tea plants when I was curating tomatoes at the Huntington. And I gave it a little effort, but I would have had to go out and get some deionized water, distilled water, to try and flush the salts out. And I think that was our principal problem, was salt burn. Now, one of the biggest problems in growing camellias is a disease called camellia flower blight. And this is a fungal disease that is caused by the fungus Ciborinia camellia. And let's bring this picture up full screen, and you can see the blight on this bloom. And this is how the infection starts, with these little tiny little dots. And then very quickly, over just a couple days, they'll get bigger. And you see this one's already gotten bigger. And then after about 4 or 5 days, this whole flower will just turn brown and ruin the bloom. And let's take a look at one that's completely ruined. Here you go. You can see this one is completely ruined. And so this disease, of course, naturally occurs in China, as camellias are native to. And we grew camellias up until 1937. We never had this disease. In 1937, camellia flower blight was introduced into California. And the life cycle of the disease is that these old flowers, you can see this one here, that's infected, the flower will fall off and land on the ground, and the base of the bloom will then become what we call a sclerotia. It's, and here's a picture of the sclerotia. They look like, they're little black structures. They look similar to rat droppings. They, you know, you can see they're only maybe a centimeter or two long. They're actually composed of both plant tissue and fungal tissue, so in a technical sense, they're not pure sclerotia. Pure sclerotia, from a technical sense, is all fungal tissue. So in this case, they're a mixture. So the flower falls on the ground in the winter, and then most of the flower decomposes, and then just the base of the flower turns into sclerotia, and then they sit in the soil all summer. And then when it rains in the winter months and the plant is blooming, these sclerotia germinate. And let's take a look at our next picture. I'll bring this up. And this is a group of sclerotia. It could just be one sclerotia, but they germinate and they make these cups on these long stems. And these cups are called apothecia. And here's a cup right here. And here, these are all little cups. And they're like this, and they're like a little cup like this. And inside the cup, lining the inside of the cup, are microscopic sacs. And inside the sac are 8 spores, like this. When the tip comes off, these spores shoot out into the air. So if you find these under a camellia, and you blow on them, or tap them, they puff spores. You hear it? It looks like smoke coming out of these little cups. And this isn't the only fungus that makes apothecia. Many, there's a whole group of them that make apothecia, and they're all closely related to each other. And these puff the spores, and the spores float off into the air and land on the petals of the flowers. And here's another one. Let's bring that up full screen. And you can see again, here's a little sclerotia right here. And then here's the stem, and here's the little cup. It's kind of fun to dig these up in the winter underneath camellias and watch them puff. I mean, it's interesting. I don't know how much fun it is for the camellia flowers. But then these spores land on the petals and infect the petals, and that's a very simple life cycle for this fungus. Now, it's always been said that the flower is the only susceptible part of the plant that gets infected. There have been reports out of New Zealand that the fungus will then move into the stem a little bit and you'll get some stem infections. I don't know that we've seen that in California or North America, but it has been reported in New Zealand. But that's not really the most important. You know, even if that's true, that isn't all that pertinent as to how to control this disease. The problem with controlling this disease, there's many problems with controlling it. Part of the problem is how long it's been established and that there really aren't a lot of good controls. You know, I think camellias were used as cut flowers prior to 1937. And Descanso Gardens in La Cañada was planted originally as a flower farm with all those camellias. They cut the flowers and they sold them for corsages, or they put them in boxes and they shipped them back east. As soon as this disease was introduced, the flower blight, then you'd put this beautiful flower in a box, you'd send it off to someone. When they opened the box, they just got a rotten flower. So it destroyed camellias as a cut flower and destroyed the cut flower industry for camellia blooms. And it was just recently, about maybe 5 to 10 years ago, introduced into New Zealand. They were free of flower blight. And unfortunately, once you get something like this introduced, it's too late. You can't do anything about it. The spores can literally drift for miles. So all it takes is one infected, you know, unfortunately, literally the entire Southern California is covered with it. But if you look close to one of the big gardens that grows a lot of camellias, you're going to get a lot of flower blight. Now, in order to try and minimize the amount of blight you're going to get, now, if you notice, this bloom doesn't have any blight on it. That's because it's too early in the season. And here's another little tip, is the camellia sasaqua, which blooms starting now, I never see blight on it because it's too early. We usually don't get rain this early in the season. Now, we got a little bit of rain in the last few weeks. It's very unusual to get rain in October. But typically, you know, once December comes rolling around, when we start getting rain and the japonicas start blooming, if it rains when the japonicas are blooming, you're going to get blight. And the other thing about camellias is they don't open all their flowers at once. They'll open a few flowers a day. You'll have fully open flowers, you have buds that haven't opened at all. And so if they would open all their blooms at once, then at least in theory, you could then spray the flowers with some kind of foliar protectant, which would prevent the blooms from getting infected by the fungus, Ciborinia camellia. Unfortunately, you'd have to keep spraying almost every day because another flower is always opening. Another flower is opening. It takes sometimes, you know, 4 or 6 weeks for a bush to fully bloom and then finish blooming. And so you have to keep spraying, and that's not practical. And there really aren't any really effective chemicals right now. People have tried a lot of stuff, and they've never really successfully controlled this with chemical control. And that, of course, is not surprising. Given the nature of the camellia flower, now it has to keep opening, you know, more blooms every day. But what you can do is remove all the spent blooms from underneath the bush. That's going to be the source of next year's inoculum. And those sclerotia can actually survive in soil for a long time. So if you start removing the blooms now, it may take several years to eradicate the sclerotia from underneath the camellia bush if that's been allowed, if they've been allowed to fall there and decompose. So about once a week, you need to go under your camellia bushes and pick up all the blooms and put them in the trash. Don't put them in the mulch. These sclerotia will easily survive the mulching process. You can also put a thick layer of mulch underneath the canopy, you know, say starting around November, just rake out underneath your camellias and then cover it with mulch about 4 inches thick. And that'll prevent those, you know, you might have sclerotia down there sitting in the soil, but when they germinate and start producing their apothecia, they won't be able to go all the way through a 4-inch mulch layer. They'll get stuck down in there. And also you'll be introducing all sorts of other types of fungi and bacteria that perhaps will parasitize that. That is also quite possible and likely, actually. And then, of course, my last admonition or warning is that if you want to grow camellias that are free of camellia flower blight, you shouldn't be trying to grow them next to the Huntington Botanical Gardens or Descanso Gardens. These are two really famous gardens for their camellia collections. The Huntington has about 2,000 plants and probably, well, maybe 1,000 varieties. They also have a big species collection now. And, you know, a lot of the other species, like Oleifera, Sinensis has some nice flowers, but Oleifera and Camellia sinensis and many of the other species, they have these little tiny white flowers. They're not showy at all. They're nice bushes, but they don't have showy flowers. You know, the ones that we grow for flowers, Camellia japonica, Sasaqua reticulata, and also some Sinensis hybrids, Those have showy flowers, and you'll see those growing throughout Southern California people's yards. Now, the other disease that is really, really hard on camellias is root rot, is Phytophthora root rot. And camellias are really prone to it. And again, this goes back to how you're watering. So you only want to water enough, or frequently enough, that you soak the soil deep, and then you don't want to water again until the plant really needs it. That can be anywhere from 1 to 4 weeks. If you're watering your camellias more than once a week in the summer months, it's way too often. You should be able to get away with even less than once a week, really once every 10 to 14, excuse me, once every 10 to 14 days. The principal means of controlling Phytophthora root rot is your frequency of irrigation. Soak the soil, let it dry out for 2 to 3 weeks, 4 weeks. That's because Phytophthora is a water mold. It infects the roots. On the outside of the root, it makes a microscopic sac called a sporangia. Inside that sporangia, it has swimming spores. Every time you saturate the soil, those spores are released and they swim in the soil solution. They are attracted to other roots by the things that exude from roots. Those are amino acids and sugars. Roots leak into the soil all sorts of things, primarily amino acids and sugars. And we refer to the area right around the root as the rhizosphere, which has a much higher density of microscopic organisms, of bacteria and fungi, and all sorts of things, you know, all sorts of single-celled organisms. And they're really, you know, it's in about a millimeter or 2 millimeters right around the root. And so when those spores are released from the sporangia, they're actually follow a chemical gradient to another root, and they'll swim a couple millimeters. That's about the distance they can, mostly can swim, maybe 2 millimeters, because they are microscopic. And when they get to a new root, they get there and they then insist and germinate and penetrate the root and start infecting that root. So the more frequently you irrigate, the more cycles of infection you get. So that's why the principal means of controlling Phytophthora root rot, whether it's camellias or rose bushes or avocado or oaks, or it doesn't matter, is your frequency of irrigation. So don't overwater, but water too often. Deep water, and then give them time to drain and dry out. That's how you control root rot. In addition, in our earlier caller, there's some other things that will really, really help control root rot on any of the plant materials you're growing, which is gypsum, which is calcium sulfate. High calcium levels in the soil inhibit Phytophthora. Organic matter. High levels of organic matter inhibit Phytophthora. And you put down about a 4-inch layer of mulch underneath the canopy. You can do that up to twice a year, once in the spring and once in the fall. And as that organic layer decomposes, the microscopic organisms, the fungi and the bacteria, and the nematodes and things like that that are in that mulch layer, that are decomposing that mulch layer, will actually inhibit the Phytophthora. They give off secondary metabolites that inhibit Phytophthora. So the combination of watering frequency, gypsum, and mulch will give you usually very good control of Phytophthora root rot. If that doesn't work with just those cultural practices, you can also use chemical control to control Phytophthora root rot. There are two widely used chemicals. One is called Subdue, and one is called Aliette. Subdue is both of them were introduced in the early 1980s by two different companies. They're really two completely different chemicals, and they work differently. Subdue contains the active ingredient is called metalaxyl, and that is an inhibitor of RNA synthesis. It prevents the synthesis of RNA by binding to ribosomes and stopping that synthesis. Ribosomes are organelles in a cell, and they are responsible for RNA synthesis. So it blocks that synthesis, and that actually kills the target pest, the Phytophthora. And so that's how that works. But being that it's inhibiting an enzyme process, resistance has been reported to metalaxyl, and metalaxyl, is sold under the name Subdue. It's also sold under the name Rinamil for agricultural production, for avocado, citrus, and a wide variety of ag products or agricultural production. Aliette is a quite different chemical. Now, some of it is hard to get. You're going to have to hunt for someone who sells it. It's not sold widely out of nurseries or garden centers. You'd have to find a landscape supply that would is selling it. It's not prohibited for the public to have it all. It's just that it's not marketed to homeowners. And it's very expensive, by the way. It runs around $200 a quart. And but if you treated a plant, it's used in extremely diluted amounts. And so that quart would probably last you quite a few years. And the cost of treating an individual plant isn't all that high, maybe $5 to $10. But it is still expensive to purchase it. And you have to go out and find somebody who's actually carrying it. The other one is Aliette. Aliette is an aluminum salt of phosphorus acid. And phosphorus acid controls Phytophthora and the other related organisms within the water molds. Phytophthora and the sister genus Pythium, and then the downy mildews and some others. So, Aliette is being sold now to the homeowner because it's extremely low toxicity material. These are not organic; they are chemical controls. And Aliette, though, is extremely low toxicity. It's not a particularly dangerous chemical at all. It comes as a powder. You mix it with water, and you can spray it directly in the foliage, or you can drench it into the soil. And it's very effective at controlling Phytophthora and Phytophthora root rot and other Phytophthora diseases. And there's a lot of people selling the same product now under a different name. Instead of, you know, Aliette is the original product that was sold by Rumplog, introduced in the early 1980s. Now, I think they've lost their patent because there are people coming up with basically the same product. One's called Phosphite, and that's not too hard to find. And then there's Agrifos, is also on the market now, and that's really the same thing. That was originally marketed to control sudden oak death. But I believe it would probably be approved for ornamental use. I'd have to look at the label. I haven't looked at the label specifically to see what it is labeled for in terms of what you can put it on. Now, those are still fairly expensive. I think the Aliette homeowner packaging is around $25 for 4 ounces of the powder. That 4 ounces would only maybe treat a handful of camellias, maybe, you know, or maybe last you a month or two. So you end up paying quite a bit of money purchasing Aliette. There are other sources of basically the same thing that are much cheaper. You can buy phosphorus acid as a fertilizer, although, again, this is not sold to nurseries. You'd have to contact one of the agricultural supply places that sells a phosphorus acid fertilizer. I know of two. There's one in Ventura called JH Biotech, and their product is called PhosGuard. It comes in a variety of formulations, 0.40, 0.60, 0.425, 0.15, I forget the fourth formulation, maybe more than that. But if you go on their website, jhbiotech.com, and click on plant products, liquid fertilizers, and PhosGuard, then you can see their label. And that runs around $30 a gallon, which is far, far cheaper than purchasing Aliette. And be a little careful with it in terms of when you dilute it and put it on your plant, especially if you get one of the stronger or the higher concentrations. 0.60 is 60% phosphorus acid. That's pretty strong. So you can use that at a very dilute amount. You can use these things up to once a month, but typically you only want to do them every other month. Or if you have a plant that's actually declining and dying, you would treat it once a month until it recovers. But if you have healthy plants and you just want to prevent it, then you'd use it a couple times in the spring and maybe a couple times in the fall, or as much as every other month. But if you're doing the cultural practices, you shouldn't need to depend on the chemical controls. The chemical controls are pretty important if you're losing a bush to Phytophthora root rot and you want to try and save it. So, we have a picture behind me, and they're not blooming right now, but let's bring this up and talk about this. This is Magnolia selanagiana, the tulip tree, or the, it's one of the more popular flowering trees, and you can see that picture. And we have a picture of the whole tree, too, I think. Let's see if we have a picture of the whole tree. That would probably be number one. But here it is. Let's take a look at this. Now, these aren't going to bloom until February, but if you're looking for a spectacular flowering tree for your garden, this is one of the most spectacular flowering trees that you can grow in Southern California. It comes in a wide variety of colors. And if you take a look at the Sunset Western Garden book, and look up magnolia, and they list a lot of magnolias, because magnolia is a big genus. There's a lot of different types of magnolias. This is actually a hybrid. Magnolia sinensiana is a hybrid. And there's literally hundreds of named cultivated varieties. And I might not have emphasized this enough, but there's a lot of different names in botany and horticulture. You've got the species name, such as Magnolia sinensiana. Then you've got the common name, which would be the tulip tree or the oriental tulip. But then you've got what we call the cultivated variety name. And that is the name, you know, somebody crossed some plants, collected the seeds, grew up a bunch of plants, and one of them had a beautiful flower. And he's decided to name that flower, and he might have, you know, in this case of Magnolia sinensiana, one of them is named Alexandria. So somebody grew that plant originally, grew it up as a mother plant, took cuttings, grafted it onto rootstocks, and sold it under the name Magnolia sinensiana Alexandria. So then if you want that exact flower, you go get that named cultivar. We call it a cultivated variety, and we abbreviate it cultivar. So if you look up in the Sunset Western Garden Book under Magnolia sinensiana, you'll see a whole bunch of this, pages and pages of magnolias, and look under the sinensiana section, and you'll see that they list several dozen different named Magnolia sinensianas. You can get them from pure white all the way to almost a deep purple, and that's why I like the deep purples. I like that color. They will drop their leaves starting right about now, and going into November and December, they'll drop all their leaves. They'll be dormant through the winter. And then depending on where you, which one you grow and where you're growing it, it will bloom in February. Now, it may bloom a little early if we have a warm winter. It may bloom a little late if we have a cold winter. It'll bloom early if you've got it in a hot location in your garden. It'll bloom a little later if it's in a cold spot in your garden. So, but they really, the peak of bloom is February. They've got a great collection of Magnolia sinensianas at the Arboretum of Los Angeles County. Go in February, and you'll see most of them blooming. Plus, they've got a lot of species. So, I see we're running out of time today. I want to thank our crew in the control room for all their hard work. And I want to thank everyone who watched the show today. And we'll be back next Sunday to talk more about gardens and all. I'm not the one who's always right.